Welcome to the Podcave, kiddos. This episode is brought to you by the Michigan Comics Collective. It's a group of comic book enthusiasts in Michigan, and they work together to put out professional-grade comics. And they've got writers, artists, inkers, letterers, all people that live in Michigan and work in Michigan and make top-notch comics in Michigan. And they are the sponsor of our show, and that's how I got my guest, Mr. Andrea Molinari. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, thanks for coming on the Paul Pate podcast. You are going about talking about your book, The Shepherd?
Yes.
And it's a comic book.
Right.
And folks, I love comic books. So that's how come this podcast is often about comic books. The guests are comic book people. And Mr. Andrea is one of those people. So, sorry.
No problem.
Go ahead. Tell us about The Shepherd.
Well, The Shepherd is actually published by Caliber Comics, which is also a Michigan publisher.
Yes.
And we were talking off microphone about the fact that I'm originally from Michigan myself. So that was a huge
dreaded Millington.
Thing. Yes. I originally born in Flint and then moved out when I was about 10 years old out to Millington, graduated from Millington High School.
Okay.
And my family, of course, Michigan. My wife is from Michigan, Bloomingdale, which is north of Kalamazoo.
All good people.
So that was a big deal.
Good. Yes. Is this your first book?
Well, it's not my first book. I'm actually a professor. I specialize in ancient Christianity. My specialty is New Testament and early Christian literature, basically the first 450 years. It's a lot more than the Bible. So that's why I want to be very careful about that, is that my readings are a lot wider than that.
Uh-huh.
So this is actually my fifth book. My career has really kind of gone through an evolution. I've always loved comics. I mean, from the time I was a little kid, I can remember being on the school bus headed to Millington Elementary, and my buddies having, these dog-eared copies of Iron Man, Punisher, Spider-Man, Batman, whatever, Brave and Bold. And we're trading them around and just reading them. And of course, nobody has any kind of, if it was a story arc, you're not getting the whole story arc. You might get the end of the story arc. You might get the first one. Nobody cared.
Yeah,
you were just glad that you could be reading comic books or just looking through and
you're looking at the muscles.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, and I remember drawing muscles when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah.
And like, if you wanted bigger ones or more, you would just draw more.
You just add muscles that aren't actually anatomically correct. We all did that. We loved them. And so it's kind of an odd thing that it ends up here. But of those five books, the first two books were scholarly, the type of thing that you'd find in a research library. In fact, you'd find them Harvard, Yale, University of Michigan has them. But maybe 50 people in the world actually read them. And that I kind of came to that realization. I was like,
that is.
There's a few eggheads like myself are reading this, but nobody gives a damn,
Uh-huh.
And so I got to do something that is going to be, more popular, but yet reflect the interests that I have. And so over time, I started, evolving. And my fourth book was a novel. It was an illustrated novel. In fact, hopefully you're going to bring that to Caliber as well. It's already been published by another press.
Okay.
It's called Climbing the Dragon's Ladder. And it's a novel about an early Christian woman by the name of Perpetua of Carthage, actually a historical figure. And she is a mystic and has these incredible visions. So it was an illustrated novel where we actually commissioned an artist, Tyler Walpole, who actually did the art for us.
Uh-huh.
He's done a lot of art for a lot of different publishers. But anyway, so my experience with that illustrated novel working with an artist was so good that I just knew that I really wanted to do it again. I just didn't know how.
Right.
That really kind of led me to this experience. And as I had said to you, over you know, when we were off the air, that this book actually, and I say it in the introduction to the book itself, this book was actually born as a nightmare that I had, an actual nightmare. And
that is really neat, because I have all kinds of nightmares. I have ever since I was a little guy. I've had, and to this day, I have like dreams, you know, really rich dream life. And sometimes I wake up thinking, I should write that down.
Yeah.
And I go to write it down and I think, that was really cool when I was having it, but it's dumb now. You know, well, I don't know if you've ever had that experience.
Mostly my experience, see, that's what was unique about this, is that most of my dreams, they don't stay with me.
I'm
like most people, they kind of melt away. You know, you forget them in a matter of a couple of minutes. You have that same kind of, impact where it's awesome. Oh, it's like, this was a really powerful dream, but then it's gone. It kind of slips through your fingers.
Right.
But this one was different. This one really stuck with me. I mean, it was one of those dreams where you wake up in a cold sweat, your heart beating out of your chest. It's really, your heartbeat really is what wakes you up. It's the impetus for waking you up.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, here I'm in bed and I turn to my wife and I begin to tell her about what this dream was about, and she was not happy. she was very displeased with this dream because, you know, basically I dreamed that, you know, I'm a professor. I go off to class in the evening, and my son is supposed to be going to a movie, but instead goes to a friend's house and, you know, for a party. And the party spirals out of control, as these little parties do. And he ends up using methamphetamine in my dream, and it kills him. And so I get home from teaching class late at night, and there are police officers on my front lawn. This is all occurring in my dream, of course.
Right.
And you know, they take me to see my wife in the morgue, and we, you know, I'm looking at the body of my son in my dream, and I can't believe that this is happening.
Yeah.
It's so real. Of course, you know, like in a regular dream, it feels so real. Like you can't, you know, pull yourself away from it.
Yeah.
And, I felt like it's kind of the experience where your dream has placed you on a roller coaster, so to speak, and said, you're going to ride this roller coaster, whether you like it or not. You're going to be on the roller coaster, and here it is, you know.
Bam.
And so I went through all these experiences in the dream, and, you know, my character, my person kind of spiraling out of control, the guilt, the feelings of what if I had done this, or maybe I should have done that, or, you know. But then, on top of that, feeling this sense that my son was lost, that he hadn't transitioned over, that he hadn't made it to heaven, that somehow he had gotten lost in the in-between, so to speak. And this terrible, the combination of those things, the guilt, the fear, and then that feeling that my son needed me. In the dream, I ended up taking my own life, which, of course, is mirrored in the book, and going after my son into the afterlife. And so that's what the book is really about. It's, as I said to you, it's a ghost story.
Yeah.
The character tells you right in the first page he's dead, you know.
So you took this dream, and which was very impactful, I'll say.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, probably disturbing and, you know, but we'll just call it, be generous and call it impactful. Then you took this dream. That probably ended when you went, you know, your heart, you know, you were startled awake by the fact that your son had died. And then you kind of just extrapolated upon that, right? Sounds
in a lot of ways.
You carried it forward even. Where does this go?
There's some extrapolation, but most of what you see in that book actually is part of the original dream. It was a very odd dream, like nothing I'd ever had before, in the fact that it wasn't just a partial dream, but it really kind of was the entire roller coaster ride, so to speak.
Right.
You know, event, horrible event to resolution.
Right.
And so I really woke up with an entire story in my head, so to speak. And that was really really unique. I've never had anything like that before. I mean, obviously we have dreams, but nothing that ever stuck with me like that before.
Right.
And nothing that was kind of branded into me like that before. So.
Yeah. I'm going to share my screen. Can you see
it?
Sure.
You bet. I sure can.
Okay. Let's see.
This is from the first issue, and it's basically Lawrence is coming to understand, you know, what what happened that he didn't know about, you know, on the night of the son of his son's death. Gosh, and yeah. In this particular, page, what we're seeing there is his son's friend, the one who hosted the party, basically relating to him those events and him finding out that, you know, this was never intended to be a party. It was only a couple guys. They're going to have pizza. They're going to hang out, play video games, but it spirals out of control. Suddenly, you know, it's a lot more, and there's all kinds of people and all kinds of elements that are in this party that were not originally part of the plan.
Right, right. The artwork is real. It reminds me of mine.
Really? Interesting.
Except
the artist's name is Ryan Showers. Ryan is a great guy, real young guy. I mean, I'm 48, just to put it in perspective. My artist is in his 20s. He could easily be my son.
Right.
He lives in Omaha, Nebraska.
Yeah, so you got a young guy. Is this kind of an opportunity for him to get into art? And does he have a huge catalog of experience?
Not really. This is, you know, he's done a couple of other books before, but this was the biggest project by far that Ryan had ever attempted, and I think he executed it brilliantly.
Was he good to work with? I mean,
oh, he was great to work with.
Right.
He really was. He's just he doesn't have an ego, but lots of talent. Really friendly gentleman. And I actually met him through the company. I actually worked with a company that helped me put this together.
Okay.
There's a company that you could find online called Scattered Comic Studios. The owner's name is Jason Duby. And basically what this is really kind of neat. I'm sure there are other companies that do the similar kind of thing. But if you have an idea for a comic book, you can go to the website. You could pick out an artist. They even have writers, by the way. So it's like a stable, if you can imagine.
Yeah.
A stable of artists, stable of colorists. They have inkers. They have, letterers. They have even writers that are available.
Right.
So they can basically kind of a one-stop shopping place where they can actually help you put together your comic book. And this 5-issue series, The Shepherd, was actually produced by Scattered Comic Studios. Ryan is one of the guys that worked for them. My colorist, Heather Breckel, was also part of that group as well. And Heather, I should give her props as well. Heather is our most accomplished member of the team. Heather actually, unlike the rest of us, has a long list of accomplishments. She's done the coloring for issues of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, My Little Pony, one of my personal favorites, Peter Panzerfaust, an IDW title.
Okay.
I just saw on her Facebook page that she's actually been hired recently by DC to actually do some coloring work for them. I know that just a little while ago she did some coloring work on a Marvel issue. So she's the big name, so to speak.
Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah.
On our team. And just,
I mean, the coloring,
just really
this,
talented.
Yeah. And you can tell the coloring is really outstanding.
Thank
on
you.
The artwork. Yeah.
I'll say that on her behalf.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I'm sure she gets the compliment. And Ryan, you have 5 issues of this.
Yes, I do. It's an entire story arc. And it's the first story arc.
How many pages total is that?
How many pages? I think it's 119, if my memory is serving me correctly. 119 divided up among the five issues.
So just as somebody who's done this kind of thing, I would say kudos to Ryan.
Yes.
Just on strictly on, like, you know, execution and follow through. And I know how much work he must have put into this, you know. And so... yeah, man, he can hang his hat on that and be proud of that, I say. Because,
well, I'm going to make sure he hears this podcast so he hears you say that, because I have a lot of respect for him. He, like I said, he's a great young man, and
that's awesome.
Just tremendous talent and super easy to work with. I mean, you couldn't ask for a nicer guy.
And to be professional on a project like this is...
And he's a very hard worker. His turnaround times were ridiculous. He was very fast. Yeah, he really was.
Awesome. Now, speaking of other young men, so you weren't the only writer on this book, right?
No. And my son actually co-wrote this and co-created it with me. In fact, it really is my son Roberto is at fault for making this happen, because I was, you know, like my wife, horrified by the dream. I was very shaken by it. And, you know, as I was, you know, relating this story, this dream to my family, you know, I told my son, and while my wife on the one hand was horrified by it, rightfully so, my son was like, oh, that's so cool. I was like, what? You know, I just told you that I dreamed you died of a methamphetamine overdose. Yeah. This is not cool. This does not qualify as cool. But he really thought it was cool. He wanted to hear all the details. He wanted me to tell him, you know, everything that happened, start to finish.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was content to leave it there, but he just, you know, the word is nag, pestered.
Really?
Oh, yeah. He was like, Dad, this should be a comic book. We should write this up. And I'm like, oh, yeah, you're right. But as a scholar, keep in mind, I had a full agenda. You know, I have writing projects and articles, and I've done audio courses and, you know, film and that sort of thing at a more academic level.
Right.
So I had my plate full. I wasn't looking for more work.
More work, right.
But in June 2011, all of a sudden, I finished a project, and now suddenly I knew that I had about 2 months open. And, you know, I mentioned it. My son overheard it. I should have kept my mouth shut. My son overheard it and was like, Dad, this is the perfect opportunity. We got to do it. And I'm like, what is it? You know, okay, look, I will sit down. I will try to write this out. It's probably not going to work, you know, but I will give it a try. So like, you will get off my back. You know,
wow.
I
mean,
that was the thing. But as I sat down to start to pen this, you know, and was talking with him through these scenes and stuff like that, it like poured out of me just like water.
Oh.
It was easy to write. It actually took less than a month to write all 5 issues.
Oh, wow.
It was amazing at how quickly it came.
Oh, cool. Yeah. And I do have a criticism of Ryan's art.
Uh-oh.
And he could take this however he wants, but I think I've seen this happen before with other stuff that I've looked at. He got better as he progressed through the story. As I'm looking at the drawings, not to take anything away from the initial drawings, but
sure,
he's gotten better, you know, as the book progresses. But that's a good thing, right?
I think it is. I think he became more and more comfortable with the characters and understood them, you know. And one of the things that I kind of learned in this project, I learned a lot of things in this project, but one of the most powerful things that I learned was to listen to your artist.
Oh,
I think too often I hear these horror stories of writers kind of arguing or having this kind of argumentative relationship with their artist. And I didn't have that with Ryan. And what I really, you know, he had so many good ideas and takes on things that I hadn't even thought of.
Uh-huh.
And I really came to realize that what's cool about comics, what's truly cool about comics and sets them apart from other kinds of writing is that it really is a team effort. And it's in your best interest as a writer to shut up and let the artist kind of tell you what they're getting out of your story.
Yeah.
Feel what did they think, you know?
Right.
And let it, you know, it doesn't mean you acquiesce in every circumstance, but more often than not, I just went with what Ryan was suggesting. And and I really think it's a better story as a direct result of that. And so I would urge,
absolutely,
you know, anybody who's doing this kind of thing, listen to your artist. Let them talk to you and listen to your colorist. Heather was really amazing because her choice of colors, like there's a scene in the second issue at the beginning of the second issue where she uses green. And she told me that I chose green. This is in the cemetery, by the way. I chose green because it reflects the sickness of the lead character's soul. I was like, oh, God, I love you. I want to marry you. But it was just, you know, to know that my team was putting that kind of heart and soul effort into it.
Yeah.
You know, And you realize that every one of these people is an artist.
Right.
You know, we always think, obviously, that the person who's doing the graphic art is an artist. Certainly the writer is an artist.
Right.
The colorist is an artist. But even the letterer is an artist because, you know, the letterer controls the pace of the story. The writer, I put it down. I say, okay, I want these words in this panel.
Right.
You know, but the letterer is deciding how those words get presented to the reader.
Right.
And it's really important. And to have a good letterer, you know, a good letterer can make an average book very good. A bad letterer can run a good book into the ground.
Yeah. And here's a great example of the letterer's work. I don't know if you can see the page we're on right now.
Like,
and don't you get it? They took Val. You know, like you said, the pacing or the, you know, you can hear this guy saying, he could have said, they took Val all in one bubble, but he didn't. It was, don't you get it? They took Val. And it's completely different than they took Val.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, in a way, it's kind of, the letterer is like, I don't know, maybe like an acting coach that tells the character how they need to deliver their lines.
Yeah.
And, you know, I have to say I'm borrowing from movie analogy, but I think everybody, because we watch so many movies in our culture, we understand this intrinsically.
Yeah. You know, I don't know if you know anything about, well, I did a couple of graphic novels and went through this experience that you know, I did all the lettering and art and writing and everything by myself. But yeah, I do think that a team like that you have is greater than the sum of its parts.
Yes.
You know, so mine, I felt like it was flat, my graphic novels. You know, I mean, they're great. Everybody should buy them. But, you know, it was this one person's vision, and it was just a level kind of where when you have a group and you work together to be creative, I think it adds so many layers and texture and it becomes, you know, a collaborative effort that is really neat. I mean, that's my opinion. So I went to, after my graphic novels, I've done now a couple of animation films.
Oh, wow.
And that has been a blast because it's what you're talking about. You know, the actors and the musicians that work on the films, like, I'm like, you know, they're like, what do you want me to do? I don't know. What do you think? You know, what would this person do, or what music should be here? You know, I can change the scene. You know, let's work together and be creative together. I think that's awesome.
It is. It really is. You know, I think there's also a value too of, you know, like what you did though. You know, mine was born of necessity because I lacked talent in the other areas. But you know, I'm glad I had the experience. I love working together. In fact, it's ridiculous. I like even video games are collaborative. In their field.
Yeah.
I enjoy that. I enjoy working with another person, being, you know, a team and doing that. But I have a tremendous respect for people who have, you know, that are multi-talented, people that can do more than one component of the graphic novel or comic book. Somebody like a Frank Miller who can draw and write, you know. You have to respect that. You have to respect the person.
Frank Miller's multi-talented. Really hard-headed is all I am. So.
Well, to get it done, though.
That's what I was saying about Ryan.
I don't know how
Ryan.
Well readers understand that is, you know, finishing is the most important thing.
Yep.
And I can't stress that enough because works that aren't finished, that don't see the light of day, that aren't published, no one can read them. No one can. And the purpose of a book is to be read. I mean, it's like the sky is blue, the water is wet, but that's what you're doing is you're trying to bring this idea to reality.
Yep.
And if it doesn't get finished, you know, but you did that. You finished these projects and you did them yourself. So
I bet our advice to a young artist or a young writer or anybody that wants to get started, I mean, well, this is my advice. Pick a small project that you know you can complete, no matter what your level is. I don't know. Well, I don't know that a lot of people would give that advice, but that's my advice. Do a, you know, 8-page story, comic. Do the, you know, beginning, middle, and end, 8 pages, and call it done. And you'll have that completed, and nobody can take that away from you. That experience of completing it then will have, you'll have a frame of reference to move forward onto bigger projects and more sophisticated work. You know, to me, I think that's, I don't think I'm in a position to be giving you advice, but.
Well, that's what I would agree. I totally agree with that, is that you have to set goals that you intend to finish and you will finish. Yeah. And this is a problem for creative people. You know, you've all met plenty of creative people that have trouble finishing a project. Yeah. They have so many ideas, you know, and you can run with these ideas, you know, but you ask them, have you ever written that down? Is there a script that I can actually look at of that? No, it never made it to the page, you know, or made it, you know, and that's not enough. It's got to be more.
Right. You're almost better off being not as talented, not as, you know, accomplished or sophisticated in your endeavors, but, you know, you are disciplined and you do what you say you're going to do. I'd rather deal with somebody like that than somebody super talented, but is flaky, you know?
Yeah, I agree. Could not agree more. I mean, I think I'm that guy. I don't think of myself as super talented, but I'm a closer. I know how to finish. You know, that's what I do, is I finish these things. I don't write a book that doesn't get published.
Right.
Every book I've written has been published.
Yeah,
and that's the way it goes. It's got to get on the CV. It's got to get on the resume. If it doesn't get to the resume, it doesn't exist.
Right. And nobody's going to read it. And that's why you imagine all these things. And yeah, that's awesome. I did that for years. You know, it was like, just start this project and 10 pages, 5 pages for years, you know, and you have nothing to show for it because you don't finish one thing, you know? And so speaking of finishing, where can we buy your finished book?
Okay. Well, there's a variety of different options. I'm very happy to say that it has been picked up by Diamond in their catalog previews.
Uh-huh.
It came out in the previews November 2015, so quite recently. It's on page 286. So you can order it through your comic book store.
Okay.
And I would urge people to do that, to support our local comic book stores. Also, you can get the collected work on Amazon. If you like digital, I know that it is available on Comixology. It's available on DriveThru Comics and their different formats. Of course, as you know, Comixology has the cloud method, whereas DriveThru has the PDF that you get a PDF that actually is sent to you. So, you know, there's other, you know, it's on Google Books. I mean, you'd have to check. I would recommend go to the Caliber website, check out not just my book, but there are a lot of really cool things that the Caliber, you know, especially we're talking to largely a Michigan audience. Look at Caliber Comics. Check out what they've got. They've got war comics. They've got horror comics. They've got Gary Reed, the publisher, has done Dead World, which, by the way, is the longest running zombie comic book that exists. It was, you know,
are there any other
Dead.
Are there any, I didn't know there were any other zombie comic books.
There you go. I mean, before Walking Dead was a glimmer in Kirkman's eye, Dead World existed and was running and going strong. I got a thing from Gary just the other day. He was talking about they're collecting all the Dead World comics into trades, and there's like 22 of them, 22 trades. I'm like, oh my God, I've got one. He's got 22 of one of his titles.
Yeah, that's amazing.
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So, but they have such a variety. That was one of the things that truly attracted me to Caliber, is that they have such a variety of superhero stuff. They've got, you know, supernatural. They've got horror. So much.
That's another thing I'd like to point out, that like a lot of people's impression of comic books is the thing they think about is Superman and Batman and Spider-Man.
Sure.
And, you know, that is huge, but what's great to me about comic books is I don't even like that much. You know, I mean, I think Batman rocks, but they can be about anything. You know,
absolutely.
There's like slice of life, you know, where there's no supernatural anything. The background music, Julia, stop singing, honey, okay? Just for a few minutes. It can be about anything, you know. It doesn't have to be about the super fantastic. It can be just about a little romance drama or a comedy, or you know, mine is about a murder mystery. You know, so it's a more of a noir type detective thing. This is about a ghost, but I mean the artwork is just a lot of, you know, looks like a lot of what do you call it? Just dialogue between people, you know,
right.
What you might see in a just a drama or something. So there's a huge variety of comics. That's what I love about them.
I agree.
I'm not attracted necessarily to the superhero stuff. I don't, you know, the artwork in it is great. It amazes me. Look at these big spreads of like all these characters, you know, and their big muscles. I mean, don't get me wrong, that's awesome, but there's just so much more there.
I agree.
And this is definitely looks like one of those that will add to the fabric of comicdom.
I hope so. We've already written, my son and I have already written the second story arc. This is plan to be an ongoing series.
Okay.
And the next story arc is called The Path of Souls. And basically this story, the first story arc, Apokatastasis, deals with the kind of, the character has one leg in the real world and one leg in the afterlife.
Okay.
As you read through it, that makes sense. But the next story arc is completely in the afterlife. And basically, it's in a part of the afterlife where the souls of dead soldiers go, particularly soldiers that have died in combat with unresolved heartache that they're struggling with, some kind of issue that they're grappling with.
Right.
And so what we do in the next story arc is we focus on the story of four different soldiers, all from different cultures and time periods, and relate their stories and kind of come to some resolution with the issues that they're battling.
Great. That's awesome. So, I wanted to real quick touch on, say hi, Julia.
Hi, Julia.
Be quiet, okay? Because we're talking. Okay, those look fantastic. Okay, they're fighting. Tell them to fight quietly, okay?
Can't fight quietly. Come on. What are you talking about?
Hey, so we kind of were introduced by Travis McIntyre.
Yes.
From Michigan Comics Collective and other ventures, and comic book extraordinaire. Travis is, I had him on the podcast, and I mean, he talked about more of the business of comics. We talked about Biani, his book, Biani.
Yes.
And which is a great book.
It really is.
Like you, I love the art. You know,
I do. Grant Perkins is really, it's a perfect, you know this as well as I do, that I think that some of the best comic books have to have a marriage of the story and art that really work well together.
Yeah.
And it does. It really works well together.
Yeah, that was what struck me about it too, was the art.
It's an all-ages comic. I mean, that's what Travis says, and it really is. I've told him what I envision is someday it's going to have 11 parts, that particular story.
Right.
And I want to see them collected into a nice hardcover and then, you know, take your grandchild or your child up on your lap and read them this story as a bedtime story. I just think it's a beautiful story. It's, you know, it has all the kind of classic elements. It has the journey, you know, the young hero and heroine having to kind of dig deep inside themselves to find what they need to solve the problems that this journey presents, the encounter with this overarching, you know, mythology of their culture. For those who are not familiar with Biani, it deals with Filipino folklore, which is kind of funny if you've met Travis, because he doesn't look very Filipino. He looks like he should be, you know, waving a claymore and fighting in Braveheart or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
but it's really, it works. It's a really good tool, and I just am really psyched about it. And of course, I kind of, you know, I told you off air that I met him because Caliber put him, his book on their website,
right,
and he was going to be a new author with Caliber. And I felt, you know, here he's doing a Kickstarter to support his next issue. And, you know, he's a new author like me. I didn't know that he had all of his involvement with Source Point Press and all the stuff that he's done there.
Right.
I saw him as kind of like myself in the sense that he was a beginner of, you know, in comic books, and of course was not the case at all. He's a veteran, but I supported his Kickstarter and I reached out to him and gave him what little advice I could about Kickstarters from my experience, which I found out he didn't need, but he was very gracious and really cool. And, you know, it just, you know, he's really been a good friend to me, but also a mentor, because he really knows the business side of this.
And,
you know, a lot of us, as we get into it because we're a writer or an artist, or, you know, we're doing some creative aspect of putting these books together. But the business part of it, you know, you really need help. And so I've been blessed because, you know, Travis is kind of coaching me up. Imagine Braveheart coaching you up, you know. You know, and then I've got Gary Reed, you know, as my publisher, who, you know, has been with Caliber since 1989 and has all this. He's a writer himself, a prolific, as I mentioned earlier, prolific writer, but also has all this business experience that he can advise you with. And so, you know, I couldn't have asked for a better situation.
Cool. Well, congratulations. I met Travis through, I know this guy. We were talking about this because you and I have never met, right? We just met today, you know, virtually here. But this is just amazing to me. You know, me having this podcast is just, I get a kick out of it, you know, being able to talk to people like you just all the time, you know, or creative people and, you know, quite accomplished people and people just starting out. It's just fantastic. And, you know, 5 years ago, I don't think this would happen, you know. 10 years ago, definitely no. But I met online, one of the first artists that I started interacting with quite a few years ago was Ken Lamoog, who lives in Las Vegas. He's actually Filipino.
Wow.
And he said, you know, you should talk to Greg Wright. Greg Wright lives here in Michigan. So, and I live in Michigan. We live only a few hours drive from each other. We were introduced by Ken Lamoog, you know, a guy in Las Vegas. And Greg knows Travis through the Michigan Comics Collective. And so that's how I met Travis. And then through Travis, I met you.
Yeah.
And so here we are. And you're in Florida. And,
absolutely.
And, you know, publishing this book that I had never heard about, but it looks completely awesome. And I can't wait to read it. And I'm very impressed by the artist who, you know, young man who was able to complete a book like this. So, yeah, thanks for coming on.
Oh, it's been my pleasure. Absolutely.
And I wish the best of luck to you.
Thank you.
In this book. When did it come out? When did you actually?
It was in May. It first appeared on Amazon, and then it's been rolled out. And there are others, like especially digitally, there are other sites that are yet to be rolled out. But that's kind of above my pay grade. Gary handles all that, the timing, all these things. And I, you know, like I said, I don't question it because I know that he knows what he's doing so much more than I possibly. So I feel like I'm in good hands with that. And it's just been a really amazing ride. And like you said, I mean, meeting all these people and not the least of which is being able to connect up with people back in Michigan. That really has helped me a lot. It's been great.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. That's neat that, that you went to the dreaded Millington. And
I'm horrified to find out that you blew out a knee in playing us. I'm glad to know that I was not on the field at the time. But that's kind of sad to hear that.
One other thing I want to ask you, I apologize if you got to go.
No problem.
Have you gone to many comic book conventions?
I have attended them, but not yet as a creator and writer. So I'm right now. I've been doing here in Florida, I've been visiting various comic book shops and doing signings, but I'm gearing up to do some conventions here in Florida. MegaCon in Orlando is on plan, Tampa Bay Comic Con, obviously in Tampa, and some of the other smaller ones. State kind of cut my teeth here, but I've also been talking with Travis about the possibility of coming up to Michigan and potentially doing some cons there in Michigan, which would be, you know, a dream come true. You go to the con, visit my home state and also see family. So you couldn't possibly leave.
I just went to, was in a film festival in Frankenmuth.
Oh, wow.
And it was, you know, I live over in the west side of the state, not by Grand Rapids now, but it was like so neat to come back.
Oh, sure.
You know, to that side of the state and be in Frankenmuth and have.
They were rivals. They,
Millington
in terms of playing football and all that stuff. Yeah. Of course, the first thing that flashed in my mind, this is terrible. First thing that flashed in my mind about Frankenmuth was they have this incredible candy store. At least they did. You know, it's been years since I've been there, but they had, you know, the old fashioned candy where you have the big, you know, baskets of the candy and then you pick it out and it's weighed according to the. All that stuff. But I have a terrible sweet tooth. So first thing that flashes in my mind is candy. You know, like, really? That's, we're going to go there. So,
Well, if you come back here, because what I told Travis was they were actually, a bunch of them were in the Grand Rapids Comic-Con this past summer. And I wanted to go bring my, you know, little recording device down there and, you know, podcast from the on-site. But I couldn't make it that day. But if you come up here, I would love to, you know, meet you in person. That would be great at a comic book.
Well, I'd like that too, especially, you know, in the Grand Rapids one, that kind of is in the roundhouse of my wife's family. So that would be.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Because they're kind of spread out on that western side of the state. So, yeah, absolutely. That wouldn't be too hard.
That'd be neat.
She'd be in the background cheering for that one.
Cool. Now, at the end of my podcast, Andrea Molinari, I always put the guest on an island.
Okay.
And you get five things to take on this island. So I tell you what it is, and you get to pick one of the thing.
Okay.
It's kind of supposed to be like a rapid fire thing.
Okay.
But it never turns out that way. It's more of a, but so it's a deserted island. And so the first item that you get to take on this deserted island is a dessert. So what would your dessert be?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is cheesecake. So there it is. Yeah. Although I don't know how I'm going to do this because if it's a deserted island with no refrigerator, no electricity.
Well, what is cheesecake for?
Exactly. You're going to eat it. It's not going to be kept. So. But there it is. It won't last. It won't be there for very long.
Good. Well done. That was very rapid fire. I like it. Good. This should be good. you get to take one album, musical, you know, what do they call them? Album, CDs, LP, whatever it is.
I'm going to take the greatest hits of Led Zeppelin. I'm going to cheat. That's cheating. It's not really, you know, picking one of them, but, you know.
That's a good strategy. How many songs are on that?
I think we'll do one of those. What are the multi thing where you have like. Yeah,
I'm sticking like.
I'm going to be there, and this is the only music I'm going to have.
You're sticking slide CCR. Exactly. Doobie Brothers throwing that in there. Good. Okay. You get to take one book.
That's a good question. I think Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol.
Oh, okay.
It's an odd choice, but it's not just for the season. It's just, it's a powerful story for me of redemption, and it's always kind of resonated through my entire life. So I would say that one.
Oh, good. We're to the fourth item. This is one of my favorite items that you need to choose one of. You get to take an actress.
Oh boy! You're gonna get me in my. You realize my wife is actually sitting just across the room.
Here, what?
She's looking, she's giving me the look. My question, just so you know, Myrna, is that he's saying on a desert island, I can take one actress. So she better be overweight and old is all I can say. you know who I think is really, there's a lot of, I really think as a young actress, I think Rachel McAdams is hot. I think she's really good. Yeah, that's my choice. I'm going to pay for that one. There it is.
Well, thanks for going out on a limb there.
I probably won't be able to return to your show.
Sorry.
I won't be allowed to play anymore. Paul, because Paul gets me into trouble.
Okay, last thing is you get to take one tool from your tool shed or basement or garage.
That's a good question. I think a hammer. I think that because if you're going to build anything, you got to have something like that. So that would be my choice. I think you, especially something that has the claw, you know, so you have that claw hammer type.
Yeah.
So you got more than one tool built in.
Good decision.
Kind of boring, I suppose, but it's practical.
No. It's I think that's probably the most common answer I've gotten, I think.
And if it's an enchanted hammer, all the better.
Ooh. Well, yeah. Oh, yeah, I'm going to definitely take my enchanted hammer.
Exactly.
You know, I was like,
fly out of the desert hammer.
Oh, why don't I grab the enchanted hammer?
Exactly.
And the enchanted cheesecake.
There you go. Always stays fresh. Doesn't need to be refrigerated.
Well, it was a pleasure having you on the podcast.
Thank you.
Do you have a website for you as Andrea Molinari?
Basically, what I've been doing is using my Facebook. I have the Facebook page with my name, Andrea Lorenzo Molinari. But there also is a Shepherd. The Shepherd has a Facebook page as well. Okay. And then, of course, again, I would direct people to Caliber Comics website. There's a page there dedicated to the Shepherd. Shows samples of the artwork. Has links built right into the various sources where you can go to purchase the book.
Awesome.
Recommend that.
Again, congratulations on a beautiful book.
Thank you.
And good luck to, you know, I hope it gets out there. And you seem like a, you know, it was fun listening to you explain the story.
Thanks.
And you do a great job of that. And so anytime you want to come back on the podcast, just to chat about, you know, whatever. We can chat about Michigan.
That would be great.
Yeah. And if you come up here, you know, definitely keep me in the loop.
I will.
Because I love comic books. But I also like just storytelling and fiction, you know. One of my favorite authors is Walter Mosley, who's written nonfiction books. Are you familiar with Walter Mosley?
I have not read it.
The movie Devil with the Blue Dress with Denzel Washington.
Okay, sure. You wrote
it based on a Walter Mosley novel. And he said, anyway, I saw an interview with Walter Mosley where, you know, the interviewer was saying, you've written nonfiction books, but what's it like to, you know, how does that compare to writing fiction? And he said, Walter Mosley said something way more eloquent than what I'm about to say, but basically, like, in a sense, fiction is more truthful because you have to look for that truth in the fiction, you know.
Yeah.
So I thought that was very interesting. And you having written just the way that you were talking about the story just kind of reminded me of that, you know, because you're looking for some connection to people through fiction. And so
absolutely.
Without having some truth there, you know, you're not going to connect.
No.
I don't know how you feel about that.
No, I couldn't be in greater agreement. In fact, in early Christian literature, you notice at the beginning of the interview, I said, you know, it's much more than the Bible. A lot of early Christian literature is fictional storytelling. Some of my areas that I work in most intensely are those areas, like legends dealing with the apostles and their journeys and adventures. And if you read them, you can see right away, you know, that these are fictional. They're miracles are ramped up to the nth degree. They're
right.
They're very dramatic. There's lots of, you know, there's dragons and talking animals and fantastic stuff, but they're great leads. And they've kind of stuck in the Christian imagination and have actually been depicted in art down through the centuries. But I've always been attracted to that, and I liked, you know, I like the idea that the early Christians were using fiction to present their truth. And that really was something that was very much in my mind as I was, you know, started turning my attention to writing novels.
Wow. Neat. All right, I better let you go.
All right.
I hope I didn't get you in trouble with your wife or her.
I'll have to unpack that, but I'm sure it'll be okay.
I love my wife. My wife is more beautiful than Rachel, but I wouldn't mind going to Canada if I had to take Rachel McAdams.
There you go.
Good choice. She's a fine actress.
She is.
All right, man.
All right.
Good talking to you again. Thank you.
Thank you. Take care, and we'll do this again.